Hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to RBI 247. So in these series, we try to discuss some concepts that can be of use to you if you are preparing for any competitive exam, right? So let's not waste time and move straight away to the session. And before moving to question number one, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So you must be knowing till now that subscribing to our channel can provide you with access to a lot of good content. And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen, which can help you to stay in touch with us. After that, I would like to remind you to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Right? So, are you ready for question number one for today? Okay, here is your question number one, which says, RBI has decided to provide an optional ASISO facility in its eKuber system. So guys, eKuber, we have discussed it in one of our previous sessions. If you have missed it, you can ask for its link in the comments. Now you have to tell what does ASISO stand here for. So these are the five options. You have to select the one which is correct. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is D, that is automated sweep in and sweep out. So guys, I think you can guess from its name, automated sweep in and sweep out, which somehow reflects the action of coming in and going out, right? Now let us understand what is its meaning in the context of RBI. So first of all, banks maintain their current accounts with RBI, the central bank. See, under this facility, banks would be allowed to set a balance for their account. So basically an absolute level for their current account. So they want that their current account should be maintained at this particular level. So this level can be of absolute measure or it can be in a range. So don't worry if you are getting confused, because we are going to discuss an example here. So let's say if there is a bank that has an account, a current account with RBI, and it decides that it is going to keep its balance in the range of 25,000 crores to 27,000 crores. So do you see here that the bank has the facility of setting a minimum limit and a maximum limit? Now what will happen if the balance of the account goes below the minimum limit or above the maximum limit? See, if the balance in the current account goes below the minimum level, so let's say the balance of the account of bank goes to an amount of rupees 24,000 crore. Now you see that it is obviously less than the minimum level, that is 25,000. So now bank is shorting by 1,000 crore. So there is a shortfall of 1,000 crore which bank needs to maintain with RBI. That means it needs to borrow. So an automatic borrowal request would be put into the system. As you can see here, automatic bid will be placed under the MSF facility. So MSF facility, marginal standing facility. So I hope you remember what it means. We have discussed it in our sessions. And if not, you can ask for its link in the comments. Okay. So same goes if the balance goes above the limit. So the maximum limit is 27,000 crore. So let's say the balance goes to 28,000 crore. Now what is going to happen in this case? As you know that there is an excess of 1,000 crore rupees. So a bid for a reverse repo transaction will be placed automatically, in which the bank is going to lend to RBI 1,000 crore on which it can avail the interest, right? So you can see here, balance goes beyond the maximum level, reverse repo transaction will automatically be requested. But if the balance lies between the two, let's say the balance is 26,000 crore, then nothing is going to happen, no action is going to take place, right? So this is to help banks to maintain their cash reserve ratio with the RBI and to maintain their balances. So banks can also set an absolute amount. Let's say they decide that the limit is 25,000 crore. So if the balance is below 25,000 crore, a request will be placed for borrowing under the MSF facility. And if the balance is above 25,000 crore, then automatically a reverse repo bid will be placed, right? So I hope you get this question. And moving ahead to the next question, and here is our second question for today, which says RBI has recently directed authorized payment system operators to implement an online dispute resolution. So RBI has said, it has told the payment system operators that you put up a mechanism in the form of online dispute resolution. Now you have to select the correct statement in this regard out of these five options, and you can pause the video and read the options carefully and then decide with your answer. The correct option for this question is A. The main purpose here is to resolve dispute and grievances related to failed transaction in the respective payment systems. So guys, see, first of all, we have to understand the meaning of payment system operators. So in our daily life, we perform a number of electronic transactions. We order from online websites, we make bill payments through online mode, we transfer funds, right? So we make a lot of payments. So the body which is responsible for holding this nexus or network or managing this network which allows you to make such payments is known as payment system operators. And there are many entities which are part of the system which are known as payment system participants. So now RBI has told all the payment system operators that you put up an online dispute resolution. The main focus of this mechanism is going to settle disputes related to failed transactions. The transactions which have been entered by parties but they have failed, right? Here you can see, access to such system shall be provided to its participating members. Payment system participants, whoever becomes part of this system, should have the access to this ODR. Currently, the scope of mechanism is restricted to talking about or discussing about failed transactions, but it can be reviewed in future and extended to cover other matters also. And if this issue, this grievance after putting up this mechanism stays unresolved for about 1 month, then the customer may approach any respective ombudsman. Who is an ombudsman? An official usually appointed by the government who has the responsibility of resolving such disputes, or who has the responsibility of investigating in relation to complaints against businesses, financial institutions or government departments, right? So if the dispute remains unsolved for 1 month, then the customer might approach an ombudsman, a respective or an authorized entity, right? Moving ahead to the next question for today. Here is a third question which says RBI has recently taken some steps to boost offline payment infrastructure in India. In this regard, select the correct statement or statements which are not correct. So this should be which are correct. So select the statements which are correct. So guys, here five statements are given to you and you have to select those statements which are correct, right? Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is D. That means option D says 1 and 4 are correct. So statement 1 and statement 4, they are correct. Now take a few seconds and try to answer this question, try to interpret the options and then formulate answer in your mind. Now the solution says the first statement is correct, in which RBI is going to permit a pilot scheme to be conducted for a limited period for development of offline payment modes. So guys, see, here the keyword is offline. So RBI is now putting focus in developing such payment methods in which there is no requirement of internet connectivity, so that the section of society which does not have internet privileges can also be financially included in this payments infrastructure. Right? So RBI has been trying to develop offline payment methods, and this payment method, this offline, see, RBI is going to permit a pilot scheme. They are going in a tester phase, that they are going to develop schemes and test them, and then according to the feedback, according to the response, they are going to decide whether to continue it or not. And these mode of payments can include remote payments as well as proximity payments. Now, what is the difference between remote and proximity? Remote means a transaction which is conducted where parties have a distance between them. So let's say if you make an online payment, then let's say you are submitting the electricity bill of your house, then obviously you are not going to the electricity office to pay the bill. You are just sitting at your home. You might be relaxing on a beach in Goa, and you can easily make the bill payment, right? So there is no need to be present there, or there is no need to be physically close to another party, right? So these are remote transactions where there is distance. And proximity payments, let's say you go to a cafe to eat, and after that you make a payment with the help of your ATM card, with the help of your debit card or credit card. Now you have to swipe your debit card or credit card in the POS machine with the cafe, and then you make the payment, right? So these are proximity payments where there is where the parties are located close to each other, right? So while developing payment methods under this offline mode, the payments can be remote or proximity. As you can see here, this pilot scheme shall be undertaken till March 31, 2021. After that, these offline payments can be provided without any additional factor of authentication. So what is this additional factor of authentication? Or additional factor of authentication, it means that there is no need to put an additional layer of security. So sometimes when we make payments, we are asked different passwords, or we are asked different information in order to complete that payment, in order to complete that transaction, right? So that additional information asked is additional factor of authentication. So sometimes what happens is, sometimes the system requires you to provide some information like some ID or password, and sometimes it requires you to have a particular device. They might send an OTP to your phone or to your email ID, right? So that is an additional layer of security that is put in place. So these offline payments, they can be provided without any additional layer of security. Upper limit of payment transaction shall be 200, and total limit on one instrument, on one device, shall be 2000 at any particular point of time, right? And main aim behind this move is to boost offline payment infrastructure in India. Moving ahead to fourth question for today. Okay, talking about question number 4, which says, Mr. A wants to register his enterprise under MSME registration according to the latest classification parameters. This new system takes into account the value of plant and machinery or equipment. Which method of depreciation should be used by Mr. A to calculate the value of plant and machinery for determining the category of his enterprise? So there is a businessman, Mr. A. He wants to register his enterprise. He wants to know that where, in which category does his enterprise lie, under the micro, small and medium enterprises, right? So the latest classifications which were released by the finance ministry, that they also take into account the value of plant and machinery. Now you have to tell that if Mr. A wants to calculate that value of plant and machinery, obviously they have to take into account the depreciation, the part of machinery that they have already used, the benefit that they have already availed, and calculate the current value of that plant and machinery. So which method of depreciation should he use? Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option is E, that is written down value method. As you can see here, so recently it was directed by RBI that all the enterprises are required to register according to the new classification, and once they complete their registration process, they have to obtain an Udyam registration certificate. So basically it's kind of an authentication that okay, this enterprise is registered according to the new classification, as you can see here. And all those MSME units who are already registered under the existing Entrepreneurs Memorandum Part 2 and Udyog Aadhaar Memorandum of MSMEs obtained till June 30, 2020. Now, they are saying that before this classification came into the play, all those enterprises which were already registered under the older regimes, that were EM2 and UAM, they shall remain valid till March 31, 2021. So, all those registered units, their registration is valid till next year, March 31, but they will also have to register according to the new classification, right? Here the deadline is given. After that, the new classification of MSMEs takes into account the value of plant and machinery, as I just told you, and if they want to calculate the value, they have to use the written down value method. So UAM and EM part 2 that we just talked about are existing regimes. So under Udyog Aadhaar Memorandum, see, these are the systems which provide an infrastructure for these companies to register. And why is it so important for such companies to register? What is the rationale behind registration? Because government provides many benefits to these units, right? And if a unit is not registered, obviously it is not up for availing the benefits. So that is why this is one of the major problems in the MSME sector, that many units are not registered, since entrepreneurs, they are not equipped with the knowledge that how to get their unit legally verified, or the systems are too complex. So these systems, Udyog Aadhaar Memorandum, the existing regime, this is also one simple method of getting the unit registered. As you can see here, it is a one page registration form, constitute self declaration. Self declaration means the company is the company or the entrepreneur is declaring the documents himself or herself. Will self certify their existence and provide some details with minimum documentation or minimum information required, right? So this was recently directed by RBI. Moving ahead to the last question for today, and the last question here says that the National Strategy for Financial Education 2020-2025 recommends the adoption of a 5C approach. So there is a National Strategy for Financial Education which says that we should adopt a 5C approach. You have to tell which of the following C's is not a part of this 5C approach. Let's see who gets the correct answer for this question. And the correct answer for this question is option C. So since we are talking about C, the correct option is C. Cooperation is not a part of 5C approach. So what are these 5 C's? First of all, content, that we should make financial education a part of school curriculum, school education. Children should learn about finance, managing their finances from a very young age. As you can see here, so financial literacy content. So what are different people going to learn about financial literacy? That we have to decide, that we have to prepare a separate content for every stakeholder. See, if there is a child who is of 10 years age and if there is a child who is 15 years of age, we provide different study material to both of them depending upon their age and needs, right? So similarly, we have to decide that what content should be provided to which stakeholder, how much school children should learn, how to teach young adults, how to teach women. So this is very important because the way to empowering women lies in making them financially independent, right? So it is very important to put finances in the hands of women. So someone who joins a workplace newly, or new entrepreneurs, how should they manage their finances? So basically deciding what to teach. After that, capacity, developing an infrastructure, developing the capacity of various intermediaries who can be involved in providing financial literacy. Who can provide this financial literacy? So first in under content, we decided what to teach. Now we are talking about who can teach or who have the capacity to teach. Developing a code of conduct for financial education providers, right? So bringing a uniformity to the different teaching methods of different financial educators. After that, community, evolve community-led approaches for disseminating financial literacy in a sustainable manner. So how to bring communities into it? So certain communities that are usually not so much associated with the mainstream, we have to we also have to make them financially literate, right? So you must have seen in many movies or so I think many of you in your college must have been part of dramatic society where they hold Nukkad Natak or street plays where they tell people that what is good for them or what is not. Basically, they try to educate people in a more interactive format, right? So how to involve community into them? So see, if you are talking to a community as a whole, let's say you go to some remote village in Odisha and there you are talking about financial literacy using PPTs or using some charts, that might not be very interactive to people. But if you perform them, if you teach them with the help of a story, a movie or a play, it might be very interactive for them and they might learn or relate to that better, right? So how to bring communities? After that, communication. Now we know what to teach them, who is going to teach, and who are the target learners. Now, how to communicate the message is also very important. The fourth C comes, communication. How to transfer your message using technology, mass media channels, and innovative ways of communication, just as I told you. Leverage on public places with greater visibility. Trying to put information or trying to present information in areas where it is more visible or where there are chances of more people seeing it, right? So you must have seen billboards carrying posters of mutual fund Sahi Hai, or you should or different finance companies or different insurance scheme, LICs, medical covers, right? So we see billboards talking about these things, or we see advertisements in television, right? So there used to be a very popular ad by LIC, and there used to be a jingle, a very popular jingle which was associated with it. I don't know, I think many of 90s kids must be remembering that, right? So how to communicate the message? After that, the last C comes, collaboration. How to collaborate, how to unite. Preparing an information dashboard, integrating financial education content in school curriculum. Basically, uniting everything, the different C's that we have decided. Now, how to collaborate them and how to bring them together in this campaign for financial education, financial literacy, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video. And if you did, then don't forget to hit the like button. I'll be back tomorrow with some new set of information. Till then, take care of yourself, take care of your studies, and I'll see you tomorrow, and thank you for being here.